You know, people think teaching is easy. You know. So what's the question again? What would I like to give TAs and beginning teachers? I think there's sometimes we make an assumption that teaching is easy. I mean, covering syllabus may be easy, but teaching well is an incredibly hard thing to do. And the good thing about that is that we do have a solid body of science and research that tells us how we can design teaching and learning environments.
Let's look at some theories from the learning sciences and see what they mean in your classroom. But what are the learning sciences? Imagine a black box. That's how behaviorists would describe your brain. Behaviorists believe that learning processes going on in the human brain are impossible to access and that they're unimportant. For them, all learners are completely passive. Remember Pavlov's dog? Pavlov's theory of classical conditioning states that through learning, conditional reactions can be overlaid upon natural, mostly innate, unconditional reactions. For his dog, the stimulus was a bell, and the conditioned behavioral response was to drool. Behaviorists believe that human behavior is also conditioned solely by external factors, such as ways to avoid pain, and that personal interests and abilities play very little role in learning. We are surrounded by behaviorist strategies in our daily lives. Take advertising. Why do people tend to stick to the same brands? Is it quality, individual preference, or is it simply because advertising cleverly links positive emotions, of whatever type, to a particular brand? The message is, buy this one because it will make you feel good. This is classical conditioning. Behaviorist strategies can be useful in teaching. Things like riding a bike, driving a car, sports, certain lab procedures, first aid, or aspects of surgery actually require immediate, conditioned responses. If it's a question of safety, there is no time for critical thinking. But the same does not apply to teaching quantum physics. Another learning theory is cognitivism. In the 1920s, cognitivists slammed behaviorists for what they called a rigid stimulus-response worldview that ignored true human behavior. In real life, people may react quite differently to the same stimulus. Cognitivists focus on the inner processing performed by humans. They believe that people are not controlled by external stimuli alone, but can choose to learn what they want, when they want. Cognitivists believe that every individual has a so-called schema, made up of personal, individual patterns of knowledge. When you experience new things, your inner world adapts and shapes your schema. Jean Piaget called this process accommodation. Successful integration of new learning into the schema is called assimilation. Does helping your students to invoke their existing schemata remind you of anything? What about facilitating accommodation or fostering assimilation? You may see a connection with the instructor's role. Disconnected tidbits of new information are almost impossible to remember. In cognitivist language, it is your job as an instructor to help your students assimilate these tidbits into their existing schemata and to develop self-consistent new schemata. And a holistic schema differentiates an expert from a novice. In the mid-20th century, Piaget also founded Constructivism, a learning theory which is highly relevant to us today. Constructivists believe that knowledge is constructed, not passively absorbed. Constructivists regard learning as an active process, not just passive storage of content. They believe that situated learning is the most effective form of learning. And finally, they see learning as a social activity. This means that as an instructor, you cannot learn for your students. No matter how brilliantly you explain a concept, the task of learning and constructing knowledge is still the learner's. It's your job to set up ways for that to happen. Problem-solving activities, for instance. or tutorials, or Socratic questioning instead of answer giving. The social aspect of learning was explored in depth by Lev Vygotsky. It is reflected in social learning practices such as peer teaching and group work. The expectations and unspoken assumptions of other people create what Vygotsky called a proximal development zone.
This is connected to the idea of zone of proximal development by Vygotsky. And there the idea was there are certain things a person can do by himself or herself without any help. And there are some things that he or she cannot do, even with help, right? But there's a zone in between where with help a person is able to accomplish something.
When you watched Manu Kapoor, maybe you not only heard his explanation of the proximal development zone, but also saw the hand gestures he used to metaphorically describe this abstract concept. They indicated the zone for a student and highlighted what might happen when a teacher assists a student when saying, even with help. Let's watch it again.
There are certain things a person can do by himself or herself without any help, and there are some things that he or she cannot do, even with help. Right? But there's a zone in between where with help a person is able to accomplish something.
This brings us to what is called embodied cognitivism. Put simply, when we process information in our brains, our bodies are also engaged. Consider how children instinctively use their fingers to count. This helps them to offload part of the cognitive task of counting to their bodies, making it a physical task as well. Especially in STEM teaching and learning, embodied cognition can play a very useful role. STEM learning relies upon concepts that are both richly detailed descriptions of the physical world and quite abstract. Here, our bodies can help us to understand abstract concepts. For example, you may read about centripetal force, but you will understand it better if you know what it feels like to swing an object around on a string. In fact, we often use our bodies to help with thinking and processing. For this reason, embodied cognitivism recommends that we design multi-sensory learning experiences to make abstract concepts easier to understand. For example, consider how geologists will pass rocks around the classroom to demonstrate differences in mineral density. Our speech-related hand gestures are also a much underestimated factor in learning and teaching. These instinctive gestures can illustrate abstract concepts in a way that words cannot.
So there are two things. One is that the gesture expresses information that's not in the speech. The audience would get richer information about the message that speaker wants to convey. So that's a communicative function of the gesture. But also gestures have function for the gesturer's him or herself. So when you make gesture, your cognitive processes change. The way you actually think about the topic you're talking about changes when you try to express something in the hand. So that would be what I would call self-oriented function.
The main learning theories we've covered here are behaviorism, cognitivism, and constructivism. Together, they provide clues to the learning process. To summarize, behaviorism stands for classical learning by reinforcement, repetition, and reward. Cognitivism sees learning as a process of information processing, which also involves the interpretation and evaluation of the acquired knowledge. Constructivism regards learning as an active process and assumes that reality is individually constructed based on a person's life experiences. This includes aspects of social learning and embodiment. The constructivist perspective will be the most appropriate for designing the exercises you lead at ETH.